Hey guys, how's it going? So because there's such a renewed interest in this topic, considering some of the new information that has come out about this particular person, I figured it was a good time to re-release this episode so that everybody can get a chance to digest it one more time to get an idea of who Adam Kokesh is, but from a perspective that was critical of him before we got the new information about what he was trying to do to Graham Smith and possibly Larken Rose. So I know a lot of people are probably going to be revisiting this episode, you know, with a fresh perspective, who are maybe critical of us to begin with, because how dare you criticize one of our own? Now they're kind of coming around and going like, hey, this guy isn't a good guy after all. And there's a lot of people who have been expressing those sentiments on various places on the internet. So I thought it would be a good idea to revisit this episode because I think it's important, and it's more important now than I think that it was at the time that we released it. So the episode is called The Truth About Adam Kokesh, Liberty's Tide Pod, and it's an episode on our show, The Lolberts, which The Lolberts is kind of a humor libertarian podcast where we kind of take a different perspective about libertarianism, you know, rather than, you know, just praise everybody who says that they're an ANCAP or a voluntarist. We scrutinize them and see if they're good people and if they're consistent and they act accordingly to the things that they say that they propose. And what we end up finding a lot of the time is there's a lot of people in the liberty movements who are snake in the grass, and it's mostly because there was another podcaster who we all love dear and hope is doing very well in his retirement by the name of Ben Stone, who taught us two very important things: that the great man theory of history is a fallacy, and we shouldn't try to look for a great man to solve our problems for us, and if you meet the Buddha on the road, to kill him, not literally but in the metaphorical sense. Which is a Zen kind of proverb or a quotation, which if you haven't heard, there's plenty of information about that. I highly recommend you go and look up what that quotation mark means, or what that quote means. If you meet the Buddha on the road, kill him. So there was an instance that happened, I think at the end of last year or beginning of this year, and the stuff that was surrounding it, where we just had enough of Kokesh and we figured we're going to spend an entire episode just detailing all of the terrible things that Kokesh has done throughout his quote-unquote career, and all the awful things that he's done to other people, all the people that he's ripped off, and all of this other bullshit that he's been engaged in, just to give people a perspective on Kokesh who maybe have not heard any of the criticism that he's gotten from people who have worked with him in the past in various aspects. So we released this episode, and it was about 50-50. There was a lot of people who were like, holy shit, I didn't realize this guy was an awful person. And then we also had a lot of people who were, very hostile to it. But I think a lot of people who are hostile to it then would probably be a little bit more receptive now that people are kind of turning. So I want to talk briefly, and I do mean briefly, about some of the new allegations and then kind of intro this episode before it starts. So the basic story of this is there's a YouTuber by the name of Voluntarist Japan, who I had on for another episode that we do on the same feed called A Fistful of Might, which is an interview show. But this happened a week or so before the revelations dropped to him, or let alone he even made them public, I guess. And, you know, he was always kind of critical of Adam Kokesh's presidential run from purely ideological stance, and not just from an ideological stance as well, but just from a practical stance as well. Like, I don't think you can shut down the federal government through a series of executive orders. I don't think that's how executive orders work, my bro. But for the most part, it's just like voluntarists don't run for office to seek to win. At best, all they can do is use it as a soapbox and nothing more, to reach out to people who are maybe not in the market for these types of ideas, but who might be receptive, kind of like a Ron Paul type of situation. Ron Paul wasn't a voluntarist, but that's a whole other thing. And he was basically kind of posting these things on Steemit. And because he was posting these things on Steemit, a lot of donators and the whales on Steemit who, give a lot of money through upvotes and stuff like that on Steemit, were backing off of Kokesh. Kokesh's campaign manager had expressed that using in terms we, which he was explicitly meaning Kokesh and him, thought it would be a good idea to reach out to a hacker and have him dox, harass, and potentially physically harm and financially harm. He was looking to physically and financially ruin not just him but his wife and his children for criticizing him on the internet and having him lose money, and potentially do the same thing to Larken Rose. Though that was not clear, but I don't think anybody who read the context of that discussion could work out that it had to be anybody but Larken Rose, given the circumstances. And again, I'm going to link all the information, including all the screenshots and the total conversations by three people: Disenthrall, Graham Smith, who was making those allegations, and Larken Rose. So you can get an idea of what these three people are showing. And all the evidence they're giving and their analysis of that evidence. So from three different perspectives, one from an unbiased perspective, and then two from very biased perspectives because they were either targets or alleged targets. There were also Kokesh was removed from Anarcho-Poco's speaking list as a result of this, because Larken Rose has said publicly he's disassociating with Adam Kokesh in every way, shape, and form. If he's going to be speaking at an event, he won't attend, let alone speak as well. And that caused Anarcho-Poco to, or Jeff Berwick, who runs Anarcho-Poco, or maybe is, I don't know what's going on with him and Anarcho-Poco, to remove Kokesh from the list and explaining the reasons why. And Kokesh has either been ignoring the allegations, denying the allegations, or saying that it were taken out of context. And I'm going to give you all the information so you can read for yourself. Most of the people, the vast majority of people who have looked at this evidence has come around and said, wow, this is completely disgusting, and cutting all ties with Adam Kokesh, which I think is the right action. But this is not Adam Kokesh's first goat fuck and ruining people's lives or fucking people over or ripping people off. And I wanted to give a complete detail again for all the people who were not paying attention the first time around to maybe give this another listen. So again, I'm going to link all of that information in the description of this podcast and the YouTube video version of this podcast as well. If you want to find more content like this, you can go to thelolberts.com, where we do shows regularly, except we've been on a bit of a holiday break, mostly because me and another co-host have been dealing with the loss of a very valuable pet who lost a dog, and I lost a cat who have basically, you know, been the center of our lives and family for quite some time, and that and the holidays have coming up, so everything's just been a little bit hectic. But we'll be back in business starting January. Hopefully very soon in January, but January nonetheless. But I just wanted to preface this and let everybody know. And also there's two things about this episode that I think are very important. So the first 10 minutes of this podcast, we kind of really just don't really give any substantive information at all. 10 or 15 minutes, I forget exactly. We don't really give any substantive information. We just talk about our experiences meeting Kokesh or knowing Kokesh or seeing Kokesh around, our history of consuming his content in various means, and how we feel about Adam Kokesh. And we said this was planned. We even say this in the podcast as well, that we really wanted to filter out anybody who was not going to be receptive to the idea by putting, to front load the episode with a bunch of filler to get rid of those people and to keep and have people who might be a little bit more receptive stick around. Those type of people would stick around, you know, give it a fair shake once the information was presented, which we gave plenty of information and linked to many pieces of evidence to substantiate the things that we were claiming against him. And all those links are still going to be in the description of this one as well. So there was that. And there was one person who made one correction. They tried to make a series of corrections, but none of them checked out. But there was one thing that did check out, and I think that it's worth mentioning, even though it doesn't really change the dynamic of the story at all. I don't think that it helps the cause, I guess. But we said that Adam Kokesh was pulled over twice for speeding. That wasn't exactly true. The first time he was pulled over, I guess he had an expired tag on his RV. And then the second time he was pulled over was for speeding. But I don't think that detracts from the fact that he was doing everything possible to get arrested, which you can listen to that whole episode and get an idea of what we're talking about. But thought we would just mention that just so everybody was knowing. But now I think that more people are a little bit more responsive. I think I better put that in there just to let everybody know that, hey, for the first 10, 15 minutes or so, we're going to be not really offering anything substantive in terms of evidence what Kokesh is. But I think it is a good analysis. We do kind of give good opinions about our opinions of Kokesh and our history of Kokesh and our how we came to find out who he is and why we don't like him for various reasons. So it's interesting in that perspective, but there's no real evidence for the first 10 or 15 minutes, and we did that intentionally. Anyways, I will see you guys. Have a good day, and have a happy new year, and Shim Hem Farash, Hail Satan. And worms. The Lolberts, that's our word, brought to you by Adam Kokesh's Legal Defense Fund. We're rolling in the cash. And I'm here with David Lukeheart and Jeremy Hind-legger.
Whoa.
Flat lever.
Zombies, Government's New Podcast, and Seeds of Liberty. Abolitionist, yeah. Abstractions, respectively. How you guys doing, man?
Oh, doing great.
Living the dream, buddy.
So this is going to be a deviation from what we've been normally talking about lately, which is we plan everything out. Like, okay, we should talk about cryptocurrency while we're, you know, and then we get into the thing and we just end up talking about Satanism the whole show. We're not going to be talking about Satanism this episode. We're going to be talking about Kokesh. And it's going to be all Kokesh all the time. And this episode is going to be called...
I feel dirty already.
The Truth about Adam Kokesh. And unfortunately, it's not going to be a PowerPoint presentation with a blue background. And my shiny bald head in front of it. Not going to be doing that.
Dang it.
But there's been some recent news about Adam Kokesh, and I have been blowing the whistle and going hard in the paint, describing why this guy is a total fraudster. And we're going to talk about how the apple doesn't fall far from the tree and his history of scamming in the process. But what do you guys know about Kokesh and his scams and all that stuff, and what do you guys think about him? I'll let you guys have the floor.
Well, funnily enough, I've been listening to a podcast that was talking about Jim Jones of the Jonestown Massacre, and I was like finding a lot of parallels here between him and Adam in terms of kind of how they, you know, Jim Jones was like a socialist death cult. Well, I think Adam's kind of running a libertarian death cult, from what I can tell.
Whoa.
Whoa. I mean,
we're getting deep.
Shots fired.
Yeah, that's really.
That's some invective, but it's kind of the same kind of skeevy feel to it. So, yeah.
Yeah. I don't know about all that, but it seems pretty bad because I have talked to people like Jack Fest who have just got off his plantation, literally his plantation, and they had some really kind of nightmare stories coming out of that thing. And I was like, whoa.
Wait a minute. Wasn't he there too?
Who?
Wasn't Adam at Jack Fest?
Yeah, he showed up at Jack Fest, but he showed up like towards the end
later.
Of it. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So, there
so
was
you got the horror
days.
Stories first.
Yeah. So Jack Fest is an event that takes out in Baca Woods, which is out in the middle of fucking nowhere, Arizona. But it's really beautiful, really fucking beautiful. And it's not a desert. It's like a forest, like a pine forest. And it's beautiful. Mm-hmm. Love it. Didn't go last year. Want to go again. And it's a week. But the first like 4 days or so, it's like dead. There's like a few people there. And you get to meet like some of the people who are really hardcore. But that's it. You don't really, the bigger names start coming a little bit later. So I was really kind of talking to a lot of people who were there or just came from Adam's, what is it? Homestead? Is that what he calls it? Homestead? And a lot, they were
coming out with
some horror stories how they were not being paid at all, and they were constantly they were not being paid. They were given like really inadequate like living conditions, and they were constantly being pressured to work harder, even though they were busting their ass for him. And there was just no thanks whatsoever. It was really kind of like he was really kind of gaslighting him into fucking working harder. And yeah, so I can get the kind of parallels between Jonestown, because Jonestown, they had the same kind of thing where he was kind of manipulating mm-hmm. them to work harder, even though they were busting their ass for him. So yeah, I get that, but I don't think he's going to be having them drink Kool-Aid. At least maybe not until now, and then we expose his fraud, and he's going to be poor now. And
apparently it was actually Flavor-Aid. I guess I couldn't spring for actual Kool-Aid.
Grape Flavor-Aid that tasted like almonds, because that's what was it strychnine tasted like?
Yeah. Strychnine.
Yeah.
Oh, but if Adam does it, he'll have everybody drinking ayahuasca and stuff. And
arsenic ayahuasca.
Exactly.
Yeah. You
know. Well, pray it doesn't come to that. You know.
I don't
think it will, but it's the same kind of.
Did you guys?
No, ever,
go ahead.
I was just gonna say, I don't think it necessarily. Hope doesn't get to that level, but I could see those parallels too. Because I mean, we were joking before we started recording, and I use the word cult leader too, because I don't know. It's just the vibe I get from that, from him. You know, I was talking about this the other night with a friend of mine, and because like I've been in Adam's presence multiple times, and the first time was years ago when I was still a huge fanboy of his because I was new to anarchism. And just like the very first time I met him, I just got these weird vibes from him, like being in his presence, and where it was just like, first he, like, I was all excited to meet him because I was just, you know, this stupid excited newbie, and it was like, ooh, Adam Kokesh is here. And he kind of just like brushed me off, and then later when he kind of warmed up to everything, I just kind of watched the way he like surveilled the room, and like, you know, it was just always on. And just, you know, kind of, I don't know, I used the word swarmy the other day, and a bunch of people were like, what the heck does that even mean? And I'm like, I don't know, this is what the word that I think of when I think of him.
Yeah, that's about right.
And then the next time was at another event in New York City, and I went to go hang out with him at an after party and a bunch of other people. And again, it was the person he is in his videos and stuff when he's on and being at like being that Adam. And he just seemed to be like, he's just so fake. And I ended up walking out of there that night. And I'm like, after that, I was done with him. I'm like, I can't even, you know, just, and then it was after that, that I started hearing all the stories of all the things he had done to people. Like, I didn't even know all that. It was just that, like, literally being around him, I was like, yeah, I'm not a fan of yours anymore, man.
Yeah. I had been a libertarian since, 2005. That's when I started getting into like Penn and Teller's bullshit, and that started kind of getting me out of the whole being a Democrat thing. And I was like, this is really interesting, libertarianism. And then I found Michael Badnarik. And Michael Badnarik was the guy that kind of really was my rock star for a while. And then I kind of had some disillusions with him as well, because he's a nut job. And a lot of the stuff that he was saying in his Constitution class turned out to be complete trash, factually inaccurate garbage. But you know, like I still was like friendly with him until he disappeared from Facebook, and I haven't talked to him since. Anyways, so I had never heard of Kokesh. You know, like I've been reading a lot of like libertarian stuff, but it was more like the academic stuff that I was more interested in but I did listen to Free Talk Live. That was pretty much it. Like for the most part, I was more kind of like reading the books, Mises, Rothbard, all that stuff. And then I remember like the whole years when I was really kind of digging into Zeitgeist, there was a show that came on this news show that network that I've never heard of before called RT, or at the time was called Russia Today. And they were like, oh, this is libertarian show on this news network, this cable news network. And I was like, I've never heard of this cable news network. And that was for good reason. And it was called Adam versus the Man. And I was like, oh, yep. Okay. So I'll check the show out. And I was like, okay, it seems okay. It's a little kind of 101-ish, but whatever. It's mildly entertaining. There's some cringe at worthy parts, especially where he talks for Anonymous. That was always made me cringe. But for the most part, it was okay. And there was a lot of kind of like stuff about truthers and stuff. And I was like, okay, whatever. This guy seems okay. And then when he got fired from that, he had his own, that's when I sort of like, oh, he had his own podcast and all this other stuff. And I remember watching a few of his episodes, and I'm like, something's not right with this guy. Like, I don't know what it is, but I'm just not interested anymore. And I was like, I smelled fish, but I didn't know where the smell was coming from. And then years later, I found out this guy was a terrible shitbag and whatever. And then I met him at Jack Fest after talking with some of his employees or whatever. And he told me, like, yeah, I'm kind of done with the whole meat hit activism stuff. And like, yeah, I totally get what you're saying. And he's like, yeah, after being arrested and all that stuff, I just kind of was like, I'm just tired of doing this. I'm going to be working more towards just getting people on board. And I'm like, okay, that seems legit. I'll have you on my program. That's, you know, he was actually a guest. One of the few guests we've had on the Lolberts. He was a guest when we did the Jack Fest episode. And at the very end, I showed him a flag, the flag that I had made for him. Back when I used to make a lot of ANCAP flags, or the anarcho-Gadsden flags. But it says, like, don't pay, and I showed him the one that says, don't pay your interns. And he laughs. And I was kind of weirded out. Like, why would you laugh at that? Because that's not funny that you ripped people off.
Yeah, right.
Yeah. And I was like, okay, whatever. Here's your Bip Strong, get out of here. And I just didn't think about it until like more stuff came out about his relationship with Macy, who I had talked to. They had just broken up at that time, and she was kind of hinting at certain things that he did, but never really kind of came out with it. And the whole exposition about him and his girlfriend just was damning. And then all the stuff about the fraud started coming out, and I was like, man, this guy keeps getting worse every time I look into him. So not a fan. Not a fan. Yeah. But I never really looked up to the guy. I never thought of him as a rock star. I was just like, okay, who is this guy? You know? Yeah. Anything else anyone wants to add before we get into it? Because we're going to go hard in the paint. We're actually going to give evidence for the things we're saying. You need to hear us out. This is just kind of weeding out all the junkies, all the Kokesh junkies the way who we're not going to convince anyway. These people are religious nut jobs. But there are people who are going to be like, no, let's hear the criticism, and this is going to be for you. So we weeded out those people. We're here for the rational people. And so, yeah. Is that anything else you guys want to add before we get into it?
No.
Nah, man. That's a good summation.
Yeah. So the recent news that we're getting is that Kokesh filed from his camp is that Kokesh filed for paperwork to run for president. And then 40 minutes, anywhere from 10 to 1 hour later, he got arrested in Texas after being pulled over twice. He had an interaction with the police, which was live streamed on his live stream. I don't know what yap he's using. His whole interaction with the police, and then they brought a drug sniffing dog. The dog alerted on his vehicle, and he was arrested, and they got him for possession of, it was like over an ounce, but under 5 ounces of marijuana and two other controlled substances, along with tampering with evidence. So he's in trouble. He's in kind of big trouble. They won't say what the two things are. Kokesh is denying that he had any contraband on him whatsoever. And he just said that this is just them, the government coming after him because they see him as a threat. Now, I'm gonna say what my initial reactions were to this, but David, what did you think when you first heard this?
Well, my bullshit meter was already full, so.
Okay.
I watched the video and I'm like, okay, why would they pull him over twice in a period of minutes if they were really, like, you know, kind of like what you mentioned earlier, if they were actually just trying to arrest him, why wouldn't they just do it on the first stop, you know?
Yeah.
So to me, it kind of hit me off like, okay, he's out trying to get arrested.
Yeah.
It's just like it's a publicity stunt to draw attention to the fact that he just, you know, did his registration to run for the president or whatever. Mm-hmm. So that was the first warning bell. And then obviously way too friendly with the cops. I mean, Adam Kokesh is famous for getting, you know, arrested for civil disobedience and all that. So he knows how to act around cops. And it seems like he was literally doing everything the opposite of what he would normally do in an encounter like that, mm-hmm. which was another red flag. And when I saw him walk over to the RV and start messing around with the storage area that was not secured or whatever, I'm like, dude, what? I've never been in a situation like that. I mean, I've been, you know, pulled over and all that, but I was like, dude, what the fuck are you doing? You know, you don't do that. They're going to fucking, you're going to get busted for that. So it just, all these red flags were popping up just from initial, just from the initial watching of it. And then as I watched it more and kind of heard more of the details behind it, it just really started to stink.
Yeah.
To me.
And I'm looking around maps of Decatur, Texas, where he was arrested. And it's a very rural town. Now, I don't know if you guys have ever done like long trips across country in cars. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Good times.
There's a lot of little towns in these states like Texas, New Mexico, and usually colored states, like really deeply colored states, red and blue states, that have these little towns that have not really big. Well, yes, I guess the interstates too, but have like these little highways that you need to take to get to other cities that go through these little towns, and the town is pretty much predicated, like most of their funds come from pulling people over for speeding. And what you
speed
do,
speed traps,
yeah, right. they're speed trap towns, and you'll mm-hmm. drive through like these areas where it's 65, and if you drive 66, they will pop you right away. And then they'll mm-hmm. they'll also do these tricks where like they'll say like you're coming into town, drop it down to 55, 45, 35, 25, 15. And if you go 1 mile over the speed limit, they will bust you. So it's not out of the question that they would pull someone over going not, what is it, 9 miles an hour over the speed limit. That's
true.
Very, very common. Which is what they said. He was going 74 and a 65.
65.
Yeah. So if the government was really kind of going after Kokesh, like if they really wanted, like, you know, oh, he just filed for paperwork to, you know, go get him, boys. you know, Ralph Wiggum, I guess. Someone said that joke. I forget who. I'm sorry. I would credit you if you did, if I remembered. if that was the case, they would have just busted him immediately from that first stop. They wouldn't let him go and then busted him again. It sounds like, yep. And this is speculation because, you know, I don't know. I wasn't there. I the government does lie. Who knows? But
absolutely.
He was speeding. He didn't get what he wanted, so he started speeding again through another speed trap town, and then got what he wanted. That's what it seems like. Because mm-hmm. the argument that he got pulled over because he was a threat to the state. If that was the case, they would have just handled him the first time they arrested him, not let him go.
Yeah.
Try again. That does not hold water.
Yeah, that doesn't make sense at all.
Yeah, and I think like a normal response, at least when I have gotten stopped for speeding, after I'm done with the, you know, stop and the revenue generation and all that, is to fucking slow down, you know,
yeah.
At least for a little, you know what I mean? Like, and then I'm like, well, fuck, I just, you know, just got pinched. I don't need to, you know, push it again. Yeah. You know, I might drive, you know what I'm saying? Like, so get pulled over for it and then immediately to do it again. And this guy travels all the time, right? I mean, that's what he does.
Yeah.
So he's not a stranger to what you're talking about, like this, like you mentioned, the small towns with the good old boy network, where you know they got to get their money. You know, so for him to do that, you know, you could say he wasn't paying attention, but I mean, after you get stopped by the cops, never a pleasant experience. I would think I'd be a little on my guard and probably drive a little more carefully, but you know. Yeah. I'd like to think I'm a rational human being, so.
Maybe that's just the clue to all this. He's just stupid. He's not really scamming anybody. He's just an idiot. That's the entire possibility, it's entirely. But what about you, Jeremy? What did you think when you heard?
Yeah, my initial reaction was somewhat similar, because I didn't even look at the story right away. I didn't get around to doing that for a while. I just assumed that he was up to something, because like you said, he does have a history of this, of doing, you know, I mean, he is the guy who went to, what was it, Monument Park, but that's in Yankee Stadium, not in Washington, D.C. whatever park he went to in D.C., like he did that, like he went out of his way to get arrested.
Yeah.
And every other so-called activism thing he's pretty much ever done was always with the intent of trying to get himself arrested for mm-hmm. ratings purposes, you know, whether it was YouTube views or whatever. So
no bad publicity, right?
Yep.
Yeah, of course.
And
so yeah,
there is no bad. That's what you want, is bad publicity. Traditionally viewed as bad publicity. It's great publicity for libertarians. Mm-hmm. We love that.
No,
stuff.
Absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, I figured he was up to something. And then once I watched everything, And then was finally able to listen to your piece on it. I was like, oh yeah, this is all, there's no way. Yeah. This is not like that. Even the fact that he could, the fact that he's throwing it out there that, you know, it's because I was filing to run for president and the people are actually buying this is probably the saddest part to me. Cause I'm like, who honestly believes that?
Yeah.
There's he's a lot barely of some, he's barely somebody. He's barely somebody in our world. He's definitely not anybody in their world.
Yeah, I mean, Kokesh did get a little bit of press, but I don't think most people remember it when he did that thing at the park. He was sparking. Hey, pass it to me. I heard a lighter.
I don't want you getting all paranoid. Or
yeah. Jim's over there vaping Tide Pods. So.
Maybe they. Vaping Tide Pods. You're like, maybe they are after me. They're after me for vaping Tide Pods.
They know.
Yeah, Kokesh is the Tide Pod of Liberty. Anyways. So. That's going in the title.
Yeah, that has to be it.
Yeah. So, yeah, that was kind of like, that doesn't make sense. It's also, quick aside, Steve Miller-Mill actually did dig up his paperwork that he filed for running for president, and it turned out it was right. It was about an hour afterwards if you also add 1 month and 19 days.
What?
Yeah. So Kokesh filed his paperwork for running for president December 1st of 2017. So what was
he filing the other day?
I don't know. Maybe he got the $5,000 in donations and he needed to file the paperwork for that.
I thought it was six.
Yeah, he filed to run for president last year in December.
Who's counting?
Yeah. Look, we're just being spurglords, okay? Who cares if it was an hour or a month and a half, okay? All that matters was that, like, he was talking about time passed.
Yeah, come on.
He was saying that he didn't do it yet. That was the whole point, is that he just did it, you know, a month
ago. Hour and a half, potato, pothead, whatever, yeah. You know, come on. They're all the same.
Could have been a time-traveling RV, man. You never know. Yeah. It was only an hour in Kokesh time. Yeah. You know.
He was really high.
In the real world, you know, we've all aged a month and a half.
So. Yeah.
I mean, it is possible it could take did it get approved? He said he filed it, not that it got approved, right? Because I could see the government
the claim
taking
was
a month and a half to approve it or or whatever, but
No.
I don't think that's what he said. It was that it was filed.
I do believe the claim was that it was filed. That was the wording.
Yeah.
Right.
Let's say that it was passed, right? Like they saw him as a threat, and it took them a month and a half to approve him. Why just not approve him? That would have been a whole lot easier. It's like, just say no. He can't run. He's so much of a threat. Just say no, he can't run. There you go. Problem solved. We don't have to arrest this guy or anything. Like, you can just say no. Problem solved. No.
Sorry.
That wouldn't hold water either if that was his case. All right. So the next thing that came up was the videotape, the live stream. Did you guys watch this, right?
Mm-hmm. I watched most of it, yeah.
Most of it.
Yeah. It's really hard to watch because you're just like, oh, shut up, Adam. Just shut up. And I don't mean like shut up. I hate you and wish you, you know, wish you were dead or anything.
Stop talking to them.
Yeah, it was just like, are you talking to the cops?
Don't give them anything.
Yeah.
That's what I like. That what you saw there was what I was referring to earlier. That Adam, like, he was on, and like that to me is just a tip off that he's up to something, because that's the persona he has created when he's out there interacting with the public, as it were. You know, you can watch it in any of his videos, no matter the subject, no matter who he's talking to. Eventually, you just, if you pay enough attention to him, that's just kind of what he does, and it's all a shtick. So he knew what he was doing. I don't have a doubt about that he totally knew what he was doing, and you know, especially that gigantic grin. Mm-hmm. you know, when they told him it was time to go bye-bye, and he was like, okay, sure, I'll turn my camera off, you know.
Right. When, like, he knows
who does that?
When he knows he doesn't have to.
Exactly. Yeah.
Right.
That's in, that again, that makes no sense. And again, the fact that he was, you know, already doing stuff like messing with the storage compartment, like, you know, and doing things that probably that the cop could have at any time been like, yo, what are you doing? Yeah. Put your hands up, you know, like.
When he did that, I was expecting them to at least, you know, say something like, hey, get back. You know,
exactly. So like the fact that he already took that step, why would he not continue filming?
Yeah.
That makes no sense whatsoever. Especially him, of all people. That's what he does. He films that he has things filmed for him. That is what he is all about.
Mm-hmm.
You know?
Yeah. And there's also little things that he was doing that seemed like he was trying to egg the cops on. Like there was a part where the dog, and I didn't really notice this at first. Like it was kind of weird at first, but then it really kind of clicked for me. That's what he was doing when Ben Stone on Twitter posted this. And he was like, this doesn't make sense. Why would you do this? Is that his dog Baloo, you know, was at the thing, and he was like, all right, nice dog. Does it bite? And he's like, no, he's a good dog. You know, he won't bite you unless, you know, you're the kind of person that would shoot a dog.
Yeah.
There's little things like that where you're just like, you're just trying to piss this cop off. Like you're trying to get him angry. You're trying to give him reasons to, you know, be suspicious.
Escalate it.
Yeah. Or escalate the situation. Another thing was like, he was saying like, oh yeah, I'm you know, I do civil disobedience and you know, I'm an activist and you know, like, I'm not a big fan of what the police do, and I respect what you do, or whatever. And he grabbed him a copy of his book and was giving. It's like you're laying out your dossier to the cop. Like all you had to do was just tell him like, oh yeah, I'm speeding. I'll take the ticket. I'll go away. Bye. Like that's all you had to do, and just not pay the ticket. And then he could do some civil disobedience with that. That's fine. But he was really giving them all of the information that they needed to be like, okay, this guy has something or is doing something or is, you know, like he's an adversary of us. We should, you know, start sniffing things out, which is what he wanted. All of that stuff was just giving them information to and giving them the reasons to be suspicious and all this stuff, which, by the way, in all of his stuff that he's done in the past, like he tells you, don't talk to the cops, don't give them information, don't answer certain questions, don't refuse them to search and all this other stuff. But he was just gleefully like, oh, yeah, go ahead. How you doing? Here's all my information. Top blah, blah, blah. Oh, you didn't. Let me tell you some other things you probably don't know about me that might be interesting to you. It's like, why are you doing this? You know better. You talk about these things regularly.
Well, he's ascended past that now.
Yeah.
that's for just your normal libertarians and run of the mill, you know, activists.
Yeah. What was the other thing he said? It's like when they came around, the dog was really sniffing in one little compartment. I guess, what do they call? I don't know what they're called. They're like a part under the RV where you can open it up. It's like towards the bottom of the vehicle. And it's like a little storage cubby where you can put all your stuff in. Forget what they call it.
Pot container.
Cannabis cubbies.
Yeah, one of them was open.
Wink.
And yeah, it was like cracked open, and the dog was kind of sniffing it out really heavily. And he was like, oh, he's like, I have one of those bins open. And he turns over to the cop and he's like, yeah, like you could have pulled me over for that. And he was like, you were going 74 and a 65. It was a justified stop. Like he was basically like telling him how to do his job. It's just little things like that. There was, you could tell, like, he's just saying it to egg the cop on. The cop acknowledged that, like, you're just saying shit to get me to put you in cuffs. And then when he was like, okay, the dog alerted, because they brought out a drug dog, sniffed the truck, the dog alerted. Now, I'm telling you that the cops do have a way to get dogs to trigger. They do.
Absolutely.
Yeah. I've talked about that at length before. As a canine behavioralist, I know full well that what is not only what is possible and what I can do with a dog, but I have former clients who were cops who do let me in on what exactly they went through with their training and stuff like that, and what, you know, and then I work with them after the fact. So I know full well what that they do that all the time. But yeah, like you said, they do it. But in this case, I don't know.
They didn't really have to.
Yeah.
I mean, let's be honest.
He might as well have been standing right in front of it with those flags, like waving an airplane in, going, "Here you go, right here."
Orange safety vest. Yeah.
Exactly. Officer.
Yeah, the pot is right here.
Which, you know.
Whatever you do, should, don't look behind me. No, which is, don't do which it.
Which is bullshit anyway. I mean, that's not a reason to arrest or stop anybody. We're not sticking up for the cops pulling this guy over.
No, of course.
For that reason, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But be smart about
it. Yeah, I'm not gonna defend like bikers beating the shit out of some guy for just saying something. But it's probably not a good idea to call a biker a faggot in a biker bar. It's probably not a good idea. you have to say like, yeah, I understand what they did to you is unjust. I get it. But why the fuck are you doing that? What the fuck is wrong with you on top of that?
You didn't have to kick his motorcycle over.
Yeah, you didn't have to say you didn't have to say like you should paint your bike pink, faggot. Like there's certain things that you just don't say to a biker, and there's certain things you don't say to a cop. And he did those. He did exactly that. And I got
the expected result.
It's hard to feel sympathy. It's really hard to feel sympathy for someone who's eagerly throwing himself into police cuffs. So the next thing that he did is after he noticed that it was thing and he pointed out to the cop the thing was open, he goes over to the storage bin and starts messing with the storage bin and trying to close it. And he's having some he struggles with it for a bit and then finally gets it closed. And I believe that might be where the charges is coming with tampering with evidence. That's where it's coming from. I don't know.
When they have the drug dog out, yeah, you don't want to like walk back. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It looks really bad if you walk over and even if they can't, you know, even if they drop that charge later, that's something that you've just given them something you can be charged with. You've given them, like you said, another reason, more probable cause, whatever.
And he knows this.
Right.
He's not. Well, he is an idiot, but he's not an idiot about this. Like he knows that's what's going to happen. Like this is not unfamiliar terrain for him at all. Like this guy makes a living doing civil disobedience and dealing with police encounters and cops and all the stuff. He knows this stuff. He's not stupid in that respect. He's stupid in other respects, but so the Adam camp is saying that Adam never drives around with contraband. He would never do that. Like, why would you think that Adam would drive around with contraband? Now, I've hung out with Kokesh. I know Jeremy. Have you hung out with him, David?
No, I've never met him, even though we kind of reside in the same tax farm, you know.
But, two out of three tax farms.
Wherever it is, I know he's got a place around here in AZ, but I've read what he's into, you know. Yeah. I know he's into the pots and that's all well and good. More power to more power to you on both accounts, man.
And for the record, we're not saying that doing drugs is bad. We're not saying that. I partake. Right. I know Jeremy partakes. I don't know about you, David.
I don't know what you're talking about.
I operate heavy machinery. Well, I got kids. I just stick to the hops, the beers.
Okay. You like those kind of flowers?
Yeah. Well,
yes. That's my green. Right there.
the claim is that he doesn't drive around with any of it because he can't possibly hide the fact that he does partake because he talks about it openly in all of his show. You know, it's all of his stuff everywhere. But you know. Sure, you want to say that, but like I have multiple friends who've hung out with him in the damn RV and smoked with him. So he clearly had it with him because he was driving across the country. So like, you know, like, that's another thing. I just don't understand that. It makes absolutely no sense. You're somebody who, you know, if you're going to make the claim that this is happening because you've been targeted because, you know, you're filing to run for president, Well, then you should be more than smart enough to realize that you have a target on your back, so you definitely shouldn't. Because, you know, somebody brought that up to me. They're like, well, you talk about it in your videos. I'm like, sure, I talk about the things I do on nationally syndicated radio. I also don't put it in my goddamn car when I go anywhere. Yeah, I was on
I was on nationally syndicated talk radio frying balls on acid, all right? I'm not saying like, oh, people who do drugs are terrible. This is not what I'm saying. Not at all. Quite the contrary. I love me some mushrooms, man. I love me some mushrooms. I'm not into weed.
Me too.
Yeah, I'm not into weed. Weed makes me too paranoid now. I used to. I tried to get back into it recently, and I just was just like, I give up. I'm just done. I'll just do my kratom. That's my background shit. That's my background shit drug. But yeah, I
low
like
key.
I love me some mushrooms, but but back when Kokesh was arrested in that in Liberty Park, what do you call it? Monument Park, whatever.
Monument Valley. Yeah.
And then Zion Valley. Coleb Canyon, whatever. No.
Kokesh
always
got to
have something.
Kokesh
about
Canyon.
Someday.
But they said they found mushrooms on him, or at his place, because they raided his house. They said they found mushrooms, and he was like, "I wouldn't have mushrooms. Why would I have mushrooms?" And then you go and look on his YouTube channel, and all the videos of him, all of his video, because he used to do videos where he did DMT. Which is fine. Like, you want to do DMT? Awesome. I want to try it too. But like,
it's wonderful. I don't know if I want to do a video on it.
There was multiple videos of him doing DMT, and then after he comes out of it, he would talk about what his experiences was, which is great. Like, I love those videos. I love the salvia ones are even better. When you're doing all that stuff, and then you're saying like, "Oh, I don't have mushrooms. Why would you think I have mushrooms? I wouldn't do mushrooms." Then delete those videos from your YouTube channel. You're like, "Don't fucking shit in my mouth and call it a Sunday. You had mushrooms, okay? Like, it's possible they did plant it, whatever. But don't sit there like this is wildly out of the question that you would have mushrooms. Come on, don't lie to me.
Beyond the pale.
Yeah,
it's come on, man."
Yeah, don't tell me, don't fucking lie to me. That's all I'm asking you. Just simple, don't lie to me. So what else? What else did we talk about? Some of the things he was saying to the cops. Everything was wrong about this. The last part of the video was where the police said, "Okay, the dog has alerted, and you're being arrested, or we're going to search the vehicle. Please turn the camera off." Now, does he have a legal right to film the police searching his vehicle?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. As far as the way I understand it.
Yeah, I believe it. I believe the high and mighty fairies in the black robes have
the ring
have decreed multiple times that you have a legal right to put, you know,
Yay.
Police have the right to ask you to stop filming, and which is what they did. They said, "Okay, we'd like you to stop filming now." And he could have said no, or at least even try. Even if it wasn't legal, he could have tried to be like, "No, like I'm gonna film you. This is bullshit." Like if it was me, I'd be like, "No, if I was driving around, which I normally don't have contraband. Like I'm genuine. Like I don't drive around with that shit in my car. Like my house, no comment. But but if you like you driving around, like you'll guarantee you'll probably never ever catch me with any of that stuff ever." But you know, if like they said that the dog alerted on my car, I'd be like suspicious. Like, no, because I don't have anything on me. I'd never carry that stuff on me. Why would that scent be in my car? That doesn't make any sense. No, I'm gonna film you guys searching my car. But he immediately was like, "Okay, see you guys later. Bye. Say bye to the camera, cop. I'm going to turn it off now. Bye." Why?
Yeah. Yeah.
Unless maybe they actually had the evidence or they're digging around like, "Oh, look, we found some pot under your little thing that you were trying to close." That's the only thing that I can imagine why he would turn it off. He was so willing that he just didn't want the evidence for people to see them actually pull something out of his car and be like, "Oh, shit, that's a lot of weed, buddy."
Yeah.
No, that's true. Yeah. That's another... But, you know, there'd probably be a way to still keep filming them without, you know, up to a certain point. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, why? At least give it like a little token resistance, right? Not just kind of
Yeah,
roll, just roll, nothing. Roll right over and be like, all right, well, you know, like you're going on a field trip or, you know, to grab a burger or something. Bye, guys. You know, I'll write you from camp or
yeah,
something. You know what I mean?
We're going to Whataburger. Like, might as well. We're in Texas.
Got a great barbecue place down the road. Yeah. You know, like,
it's no In-N-Out. It's no Tommy's, but it's Whataburger. Whatever.
That's good.
Yeah.
That's good.
I'm going to get some angry mail from Clayton. Hi. Go ahead.
I don't know. I don't know what any of those things are. I mean, I know what they are, but I've never had any of them. So.
Yeah.
Or you, come on
or you
out,
can,
man.
Or you can be a complete burger cuck and like Five Guys, but go ahead.
I don't. Sadly, Five Guys is one of the best things we have over on this end of the, at least yeah. where I am.
So I'm okay with Five Guys.
I enjoy Five Guys. I'm a big fan.
But why have Five Guys? You have In-N-Out and Tommy's. That's
well,
all
yeah,
I'm saying.
Yeah, so I'm saying we don't have those. Yeah. So
like only a jerk.
No one knows what Tommy's is. Where's Tommy's? Nobody knows what Tommy's is.
Tommy's is our new
In-N-Out. I think it's something only you know about. Yeah. Is it just in Vegas or what?
It's Southern California and
SoCal,
which basically okay. Vegas is. It's like Southern California without like we're gonna be a part of you, but we don't want any of your dumb laws. We want guns and gambling and hookers. Like fuck you.
Just send us your good burgers.
Right. Yeah. Just give us your fast food stuff. Yeah, it's all about chili. Word. If you don't like chili, it's not your game. But
All right,
chili.
Yeah. Anyways, go ahead. Sorry to interrupt. we're going on a field trip. That's where you left off. Before I interrupted you.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's you know you're going to the clink. You know what I mean? You're not going to you know down the road to a happy place.
Yeah.
So what you know?
And he had a shit-eating grin on his face the entire video.
I don't know if he's just trying to play it cool or tough. You know, but.
Yeah, he was. Yeah, it was like, he was happy. It's like when they told him, like, okay, we're gonna search your car. He turned the camera on himself, and he had a big old grin on his face. He was happy. Like, fuck yes.
Yeah,
I did it. They're gonna give me money.
Almost. Yeah. That's what. Yeah. Yeah. He was almost manic. I mean, that's what it was. He's like, oh, dude, I'm gonna get so many donations. You know, for this.
Yeah, and he did.
Yeah.
In a matter of one day, he pulled in like $6,000, in donations for his bail fund. Now, so this is where we're going to start saying that.
I don't even know why he needed that. He's been cleaning up on Steemit while being in jail because his girlfriend and his friends are posting on there, and they're getting mm-hmm. like you know $500, $600, $700, $800 a post for like these ridiculous updates that are like basically like updates about the dog too. Like there's been multiple updates about the dog, and these things are getting a couple $100 a pop.
So I don't do Steemit, but you're free to post anything on the Lolberts on Steemit for your money. Go right ahead, there, Jeremy. It's all you.
Oh, okay.
Sweet. You're the only one that uses Steemit as a Lolbert, which I have problems with, but whatever. That's a different show. We already did that show, actually.
Exactly.
We already did that show. What am I talking about?
Exactly. But they're bringing yeah. So they're bringing in. He's bringing in a heck of a lot of money in a hurry. Just you know.
Yeah. So So after that happened, they were starting to post this link, and I don't know what the link was to exactly. I don't know what fundraising website they were using. I could look it up while I talk a little bit and kind of filibuster, and I'm using the wrong browser, so
yes.
Okay. Why don't you guys look it up? It's on his Facebook page.
I
have to use Chrome when I'm recording because I'm doing
show notes.
I guess
I can look
stuff.
It up though.
Yeah. Anyways, I normally use Firefox. That's where I'm logged into Facebook. Anyways, what was I going? Oh, yeah. So the donations. They kept posting this link on every single one of their updates, like to help bail money out of Kokesh out of jail. And so everybody's been donating to this link. And last I heard, there was about $6,000, according to them. There's about $6,000 of money per last update to the bail fund. And so people are donating money, thinking that, oh, we're going to pay for his bail for him to get out of jail so he can be a free man, like help get Kokesh out of jail. Donate to this link. And he did this up, or his girlfriend or one of his, no, I don't think it was his girlfriend. I think it was one of the other team members, went on this podcast called, or TV YouTube show called The Honest Media, which is supposed to be a thing about Trump's dishonest media thing. And it's a Trump show. Like you see like little Trump hats and a little Trump bear, and they're Trumpkins.
Fake news.
Fake news. Yeah. And they went on there and they said, we haven't renounced this yet, but I'll tell you this now because, you know, this is important, is that we're not going to give the money for Kokesh's bail to the government. We're not going to negotiate with terrorists and all this stuff, which is fine. Like, that's great. Like, you don't want to give the government money? Awesome. I'm all for it. You know, bribing them to get out of jail, that's tempting. I get it. I understand all the points either side. I get it. It's his choice. But if you're going to be raising money for bail, you can't just say, give us money for bail, and then even include the link on the video where you're saying you're not going to use the money for bail and say on there, help get Kokesh out of jail by donating to this bail fund. Come on. But they said that they're going to take the money and donate it to the Libertarian Party National, because that's where they think the money should go, and they're not going to go negotiate with terrorists and stuff. That's fine. But you can't take money that was already collected for a specific goal, which is getting him out of jail, and the turnaround of giving it to the Libertarian Party. Now, I understand a lot of people don't like the Libertarian Party, including people who like Kokesh.
Well, that's the point.
Yeah.
Most of his fans are anarchists, and I'm sure they're not willingly handing their money over to the LP, most of them normally. So
yeah,
it's a really scummy move.
And I even pointed this out, like, guys, like, if you think this isn't a scam yet, you're gonna get really, really mad if you donated to his bail fund, because it's not gonna go to his bail. It's going to the LP National.
But wait, there's more.
Allegedly, because and we're gonna get into this later, where we're talking about some of the things he said that, oh, we're gonna do this with this money, and then the money just vanishes. It doesn't go where it's supposed to go. People didn't get paid when they were contracted with him to do work. Lots of that stuff. So we don't even know if it was going to go to the LP at all anyway. Like, it could have gone right in his pocket, you know? And I definitely want
to... Maybe he used it to fix the storage compartment on his RV.
On the Freedom Line.
You know.
So he announced an update yesterday while I was asleep, and then I woke up and I saw it, and I was infuriated because I was like, this is proof this is a scam. Because... I was calling him the American Sargon. What would you say? Sargon of Kokesh?
Sargon of Kokesh. Yeah.
So Sargon of Kokesh, which is a guy...
May he forever reign.
Reign in Kekistan. yeah, this guy, he looks oddly like Sargon of Akkad with an American accent. I guess he's part of Adam's team. Posted an update on his official thing saying... Okay, guys, there was a lot of confusion what was going on here. I got a thing from Adam, and I'm just going to read it. And the thing said, we're not, no. You got us fucked up. We're not doing that. We're not giving the money to the Libertarian Party. Okay. We're giving the same amount of money that we got for the bail fund to the Libertarian Party, but it's not coming from that. And that was intentional. It was completely intentional. We're not backtracking here at all. This is you just got us fucked up. Okay, that's what it is. What we're gonna do is we're gonna donate $6,000 that we got from bail. We're gonna match those funds to the Libertarian Party out of our own pocket, and then the $6,000 we're gonna give to the bail money is still gonna go to Kokesh's bail, but we're not gonna go negotiate with terrorists, and we're not gonna give the money to the government.
Oh, so, my God.
What does that even mean? You're gonna
You know what it reminds me of is the scene in Friday where what's his name? Smokey's paying big worm. Oh. He's got like $100 or something in his hand, and he's like counting it out, and then he flips it over and like tries to count it, you know, like, oh yeah, I got your money right here, you know.
He's like, don't play me, that's $100. And he's looking at it, he's like, it's only 60, and he's like, here you go.
that's totally fucking what it reminds me of, you know, like, oh my God.
Well, see, so many questions come out of this because first of all, if they're able to match the funds the people donated, then why did anybody need to donate?
Bingo.
Yeah.
Ding, ding, ding. Yeah.
Oh, man. That's like, I mean, just based on the amount of, you know, fans he still seems to have, I guess there are a lot of stupid people, because so many people are just really like completely, it's so blatant. Yeah. It really is. I mean, like you said, they put out their correction video leaves you even more confused yeah. about what's actually happening.
Oh, and they're eating it up. The original they're video. Eating it up. I don't understand how you could eat it up because it says in the video, we're using the money for bail, but we're not going to pay for bail. So where the money's going? That's the logical conclusion from that. And if you go in the thing, everybody's like, yeah, fight the power, Adam. Are you even paying attention?
Take my money and don't give it to them. Yeah. That's right. That'll show them
and get you out of jail.
Just hang on to it. They know it's there. Yeah. You know, like they know you could get out at any time, you know, really sucking it to them.
Yeah, even though they haven't even said how much bail is going to be or even eligible for bail. We don't know. They haven't said. You know, they denied Cantwell. And Cantwell, for all of his faults, all of his many, mm-hmm. many, 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 many faults, was innocent of what they were accusing him of that yeah. specific charge that they were leveling him. He was doing Correct. Something similar. There's no doubt. But yeah, but many faults. That was not one of them. And they denied him bail for the longest time too. So, and that was just for what, pepper spraying someone who was attacking him.
So maybe he's just trying to out Cantwell.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know.
He'll be a border Aryan soon. Border Aryan.
Border Aryan.
You had it right the first time.
Yeah, but it's kind of hard being Jewish. Being a border Aryan.
Yeah.
Border Aryan. Yeah.
Oh, Jewish. I know a few who are.
Oh, okay. Who? Is it Jared? Huh? Who?
No,
okay.
He's not.
Okay.
One of his good friends though. Yeah. But it's actually not really that hard if you think about it, because I mean, look what they are like in their homeland. They're serious Bordertarians over yeah. there.
Absolutely.
Because they got a legit wall.
And socialist to boot.
Yeah. So yeah, the money looks like. From what I understand right now, it's just going directly into their pocket. They haven't said what they're going to do with it. They said it's going to go to bail, but at the same time, they said it's not going to bail. So Kokesh is just basically having a surplus amount of cash. We don't know if they're actually going to give the LP the money. I'm going to try my best and do everything I can to try to get some information out of the LP after all this is done to see whether or not money was given to the LP under his name. We'll see. Or at least get him to provide proof that money was donated to the LP. I want to see that. But either way, if you're going to be taking money for bail, if you're going to say like, hey, I'm in jail, I need money to get out on bail, and people donate thousands of dollars to you, and you don't decide, oh, I'm not going to go out on bail, you need to refund those funds immediately.
Give it back.
Because that is by definition fraud.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
No matter what you give the money to, even if you give it to sick kids hospital, that's fraud. Even if you were to take money for sick kids hospital, then realize like, I don't like sick kids hospital. I'm going to give it to fucking Ronald McDonald Land charity or whatever it's called. You know, that does the same thing. You still need to be like, return your money and then we'll start again. We're going to do it for Ronald McDonald's house or whatever it's called. Right? Am I wrong here?
No. Okay. You're absolutely right.
It's fraud. Yeah. On every level, but this is not even that much of a difference. There's a difference between saying, hey, I need to get out of jail versus we're going to give it to the Libertarian Party so that they can promote liberty.
Yeah.
Or at least give people the option like, hey, if you donated money, we've decided not to use it for this, but we'd like to, you know, have it earmarked for something else. But if you want your money back, give it at us and we'll refund you. But you have the option of letting us use it for something else. At least give people the option, not just like, oh, okay, well, yeah, you handed over your hard-earned money for this purpose, but we're going to do this other thing with it. We're going to use it for bail, but and what I mean by bail is more weed. You know what I mean? Probably allegedly.
But this is fraud.
You know what I mean? But yeah, it's fraud no matter what the other purpose is. It's you're defrauding people of their money.
Yeah. And this
end
is
the story.
And this is not the first time. We need to make this clear. Kokesh has a very long history of making money that was donated for one cause disappear. For hiring people to do a service and then rent payments were never rendered, or buying a service, and then once the service is being provided, skip payments and then slander the companies that are doing this. And we're going to go over a few big, the bigger examples of this too. So which one should we crack with first? Or, yeah, we'll get into so the, we'll get into his other protests later where he's actually doing civil disobedience and if it's real or not. But so let's talk about Derek J. Freeman. You guys know who Derek J. Freeman is, right? I hope so.
Absolutely.
Jesus Christ.
Absolutely.
Of course. I've met the man.
Okay. I have not.
He's a solid dude, man, from what I
can tell. He's awesome. I love Derek. Yeah. He's great. Yeah.
And he's queer as blazes, but we all love him.
Yep.
He's got the Bitcoin only store, I think, in
New
Hampshire, right?
Him and Steven.
Yep.
And
that's pretty correct.
He's a civil disobedient as well. Like, he actually does really good civil disobedient stuff.
But he did it. He did it right.
Yeah.
It was funny.
He didn't talk to the cops. He didn't provide them information. He didn't do any of that stuff. He was just like, hey, why are you guys doing this to me? I'm not hurting anybody. And he would not comply and, you know, drop like a fish and have them drag him away. You do all those things, all those stuff that Kokesh used to do, but actually do it, not fake it. So Derek J. Freeman for a while was a paid intern, a quote unquote paid unquote intern for Adam Kokesh. Kokesh hired him to do some work for him, wrote out a contract saying, like, I'm going to pay you X amount for this work. Derek J. provided that work, did the work exactly what he says. Kokesh even confirms that, yes, he did the work that he was doing for me, and then denied ever agreeing to pay for him, even though there was written agreement between the two, and released email exchanges and talked about the interactions that he'd had with him on YouTube videos, which he later took down. Just because he seems like he was getting an awful lot of, he was getting a maelstrom of hate from Kokesh, like true believers, saying like, no, you're wrong. Like, how dare you criticize? He done so much for liberty, et cetera, et cetera. And there's a link in the description to the show notes to all the stuff that I'm alleging here. You can go and read it for yourself and be your own judge. Think about it rationally. You're already this far in, you probably are, so he owed him, at the time, was $432, I believe. I can go and look it up, actually. About $432 worth of Bitcoin, which at the time was 31 Bitcoin. Think about that.
Yep. But
even after the fall-off that just recently happened, you know, the knife drop. That's a shitload of fucking money.
Yeah.
Even if I round it down to $1,000, that's $31,000 this would have been worth now. And when he first started going public with this stuff, Bitcoin had jumped up at that time, and I think it was worth like a few thousand dollars, just a couple thousand dollars or something, which at the time, that's a shitload of money as well. But and Kokesh refused to pay it, and then finally he was like, yeah, you're right, I was wrong, I did you wrong, but I'm not gonna pay $400. And it's $400. The dude is fucking rich. Like, he has the money right now. Right now, he has the money to pay him off and be fine, but he's not going to.
Nope.
And it's only $400. Like, that would be it's a drop in the bucket compared to what he has on him, right? At least what we know right now, at least $12,000.
Yeah.
Yeah. So what's happening?
Jesus. No, yeah, I'm just reading through the emails and I just feel dirty.
Yeah.
Need to be cleansed.
And the evidence is there. Like, he's fully admits that, you know, he took the money and ran, even though Derek J. did agree, but he's saying like, yeah, I'm just not going to pay you. Like, I just, and he did like this and it's gone too. And I wish Derek, please tell me you just privated these videos or something that I can pull them up somehow. Where he was like, they were having a phone conversation with him and he's like, yeah, so you're going to pay me? And he's like, no, I just wanted to kind of mend the fences and, you know, just put all this stuff behind us and everything. And, you know, I want to be on good terms with you again. And he was like, okay, so you're going to pay me? And he was like, no, I just want to mend the fences. That's how you mend the fences, you fucker.
It costs money to mend fences.
Yeah.
It's materials, time. Yeah. Come on, man. This is fucking basic economics.
What are you, a commie?
You know.
Well, he was setting up that commune to go live in an Earth ship, wasn't he?
Yeah. Yep. And to this day, Kokesh is not paying. even if you say like, okay, 31 Bitcoin, that's ridiculous now. Ridiculous to for him.
And even Derek said that. Derek said along that he would just take the FRN value of what he was owed at the time. He was fine with that. Even once the price went up, he's like, I don't care. He's like, if he just gives me what he actually owed me, then I'll let it go.
Yeah.
And he didn't.
Totally gracious and reasonable, you know.
Yeah, because there's plenty of people who wouldn't. Plenty of people have been like, no, motherfucker, you owe me 31 Bitcoin. You know, like.
Yeah, that happened to Ben Stone.
Oh, that's.
Famously or infamously.
Yeah.
Right.
So the next one is Shield Mutual. This one's a little tough because it's a really, really long, drawn out, very meticulous and methodical, like, case against Kokesh. And it's very long and there's no summary. But I'm going to give you the summary for it. And you can read the entire thing for yourself and see all the evidence right there in front of your face.
There's no summary, but I'm going to give you one.
Yeah. There's no summary on the page. But
I know,
link it. Yeah. I'm going to summarize it for you.
But wait.
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, go on.
Okay. So Shield Mutual was a legal defense fund for activists, if I recall correctly. It's a legal defense fund for activists in the libertarian community. What you do is you pay this monthly fee, and if something happens to you within the legal system, they would come out and help defend you and try to get you out of jail and remedy the situation as fastly as possible while still being very kind of in the libertarian activist community and you know, abiding by all the things that you should do to be a good activist. They were really good company for a while. It's since closed, probably mostly because of their backlash with Kokesh. Kokesh, what's the difference, really? I was about to say Cantwell.
Cantcash.
Yeah, so Kokesh.
Cokewell.
Cokewell, that's it.
Anyways, I'm coked well. So
well coked.
Fitting.
Sorry, go on, man.
So Kokesh was paying for this service, and he got arrested. And after he got arrested, George Donnelly.
Shocker.
Yeah, who'd have thunk it?
Get right out of town.
Kokesh arrested? Impossible.
Inconceivable.
I don't think you're saying that word. I don't think you're using
it. You keep using that word.
I don't think you mean what you think it means.
It means what you think it means.
Anyways, after being derailed 3,000 times, we continue. So they came out and they went to his defense and they were kicking ass for him. They were really kicking ass for him and helping him out the best they could. And in the process, he stopped paying. He stopped paying the monthly fee that you need to pay in order to keep the service going. And they kept writing email after email saying, hey, we love doing business with you and we're glad to help you. And we've been working really hard to help your case and everything, but you're not paying. And there's been email after email where saying, just making excuses about why they're not paying. And then they said, okay, well, if you're not going to pay us per the agreement for the contract that you signed, we're going to be pulling back services and you're on your own. You know, sorry that it had to end this way, but whatever. And then Kokesh, after he got out and everything, went on this big smear campaign against George Donnelly and saying, like, this guy is a fraud and a con man. He didn't give us the services that we provided. And so Donnelly wrote this really long statement on Shield Defense website saying, this is exactly what happened. This is our side of the story. Here is the evidence to back up our side of the story, that Kokesh did not pay for the services that were being rendered to him. So we stopped rendering the said services. That's it. And here's the evidence. And Kokesh is now going on a smear campaign, slandering us and accusing us of things we never did. And here's some of the other evidence that shows that this guy is not someone that you want to do business with in the future. And we're not going to ever do business with them again, even if he does pay us. We're going to just refund the money and say we're not interested in doing business with you. So that's one. That's in the description. Did you guys know about this at all? When it happened?
No, I hadn't heard of it till today.
Yeah, no, I was this one I was unaware of.
Well, that's news you can use. And this is from 2013, by the way. This is
the more you know.
This all this stuff goes way, 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 way back. So there's like two real clear examples that this guy doesn't. Now, MK Lords had written an article called Libertarian Welfare Queens. And she cited some things that happened that, you know, I can't really find any information that proves it, but I know it's true because a lot of people have said it's true. A lot of people have donated to these things and got burned and got ripped off, come back and say, like, yeah, that's what happened to me. And I've talked to these people. So this is for the most part hearsay, so there's no like documentation for it that I know of. If you have it, please provide it, and I would love to throw it in the show notes. But in that he was planning on doing a tour across the country, and his first Freedom Line, before pre-Freedom Line, Freedom Line. And he raised like $50,000. Let me pull this up to just get the numbers right. Let me get the numbers right. $50,000, was it? $50,000.
I'm reading $50,000.
Okay. Well, no. Okay, so $50,000 down the memory hole. And then they raised another $30,000 after they said, hey, we lost the money. We don't know what happened. We need to raise money to go on this tour. Please hashtag please donate. And then they went on their tour. So there's $50,000 just
poof.
Gone. Just gone. All this money that was raised to go to this trip, just gone. What does it say exactly? I don't recall. I read it yesterday, but it was like me also me scrambling trying to get to work at the same time. Anybody? Anybody? Anyone?
Wait, what did you say? What did it say?
Anyone?
Bueller.
Bueller. Anyone knows what George Bush called this in 1981? Anyone? Something. D-O-O economics. Voodoo economics.
Voodoo. It's voodoo, man.
All right, so go ahead.
Do the voodoo that you do.
So what did this say?
What did what say? I'm so confused.
Okay, so here we go. So I'm going to post a link, and you can read the thing for yourself, and I'll read the part in question. So then again, so this continues on. Then there's this is Rich. He blamed his buddies for the missing funds. That's $50,000 down the memory hole. Mind you, donors whined that he got his poor girlfriend to give him some half-assed explanation. Everyone promptly forgot and no lawsuit was filed. Then, if that wasn't enough for libertarians to at least question his judgment, he goes on a book tour to spread the good word of liberty. Oh, I guess this was the Freedom Line, I guess. Then I can understand needing to hustle when you get out of jail. But the dude just got another $30,000 from people for this tour.
Jesus.
Yeah. Even after him or his team disappeared $50,000. Read that last sentence again. It really sinks in. And I'll read it again. I can understand people needing to hustle when you get out of jail, but the dude got another $30,000 from the people of this tour. And that's after his team lost $50,000.
Jesus.
Yeah. This guy is, and to top it all off, to top all of this off, the dude is fucking rich. Like, the guy comes from fucking money. And scammy money too. Like, the apple did not fall far from the tree. We should talk about Kokesh's dad. Kokesh's dad, Charles Kokesh. I almost said Charles Koch. Charles Kokesh. Let's see.
Tomato, tomato.
Yeah. Yeah. 1 hour, 2 months. What's the difference?
Right.
So Kokesh's dad, Charles Kokesh, got in a lot of trouble with the SEC because he had a scheme, kind of a land investment scheme, where he was basically taking money from investors and kind of paying off big investors with small investors. It's almost like a pyramid scheme, but kind of on. It really depends on how much you're donating versus like when you got in and when you got out. It's a different kind of. It's not really a pyramid scheme, but it is fraud. So what he was doing was he was taking all this money from investors and then paying off the big investors with the small-time investors. So people who were investing like in the realm of a few thousand dollars, $5,000, money was being taken out of the accounts from those and then given into the people who were investing millions of dollars into these funds. And the SEC, the Securities and Exchange Commission, cracked down and said, no, this is fraud, and you're going to pay them back. With all kinds of crazy restrictions and loopholes. The Cato Institute stepped in and a few other libertarian organizations said, like, yeah, this guy did commit fraud, but you're kind of overreaching a bit in terms of the penalty, which I agree with their analysis. I think that they were kind of overreaching. But at the same time, yes, this guy needs to pay back with interest what he defrauded all these people from. This guy is a millionaire, and he's a big, big guy in the Santa Fe, New Mexico kind of area development, you know, big money. He's really well into money. So Kokesh's dad constantly bails out Kokesh and pays for stuff for him all the time, while at the same time, people are donating thousands of dollars to Kokesh for doing activism, which he doesn't need. His dad can pay it off. He has money in the bank as well. He can pay it off himself. But Kokesh still is saying, hey, where's my little tin cup? Please, I need money. Money. All the time.
Coins.
Yeah.
Alms.
Alms for the poor. And he's not poor. This dude is rich. He gets money from his dad, who is also a scammer. Convicted scammer. I can say that. he's a convicted fraudster. And why would you expect the apple to fall far from the tree as well? You guys didn't know about this, right? Is this news to you?
This is news to me too.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I'd only heard I think I heard briefly about this a while ago, but again, I kind of forgot about it. I knew he had money. I knew he had money.
Yeah, I knew that.
I knew that much, and I knew that he, you know, I knew that Adam, of course, was well taken care of because of that, which is why I remember when MK first wrote that piece, the Libertarian Welfare Queens piece. I think I was still a fan of Molyneux at that point. I think I took it offensively, but the only one I didn't at the time was against Adam, because I'm like, oh yeah, he's a total douche.
Oh no, that's right.
Yeah, I'm sure everybody. I think everybody here hated Cantwell from the beginning. Did anybody here actually like Cantwell?
I did.
Oh, you did?
Okay.
Yeah, back when I knew him here, like he was fine. Like I didn't have a problem with him, and then it was, you know, he just got crazier and crazier.
Yeah, I didn't know him until he did the thing about the cops. Like, so she go telling everybody go and kill cops. That's what I was like, who the fuck is this guy? This guy sounds like a cop. The first time I heard his name, there was a Facebook page being created, and it invited me to like it. And I was like, what the fuck is this? Chris Cantwell's a cop? Who the fuck is Chris Cantwell? And I go on his website, and he's got this thing about killing cops. And I was like, oh, yeah, this dude's a cop. that was my first kind of intro to Chris Cantwell. So I've never been a fan.
Yeah, I kind of found him at the end of his – or the beginning of his downward spiral. So I never really got into him.
Okay.
But
you kind of knew him personally, so I guess you can kind of, that's a different kind of take. Yeah. I knew some other people too, hi Drea, who who actually knew him and liked him at the very beginning and then realized like, oh, this guy's a fuckbag, fuck him. So
yeah.
What else? Oh, so his protests. So a lot of his protests are fake, and there's one that I can definitively prove without question is a complete fraud, and that was when he smoked weed in front of the White House and got arrested. Do you guys remember when this happened or no?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't remember this happening because this is at the time where I was like, yeah, I'm over this guy. I'm not going to follow him anymore.
Yeah.
Okay.
I wasn't following him as much, but I still remember it.
Okay. So he did this activism, and we're also going to talk about, remind me to talk about Steve Miller, what he said about Kokesh too, because we need to talk about that. Because, oh, by the way, Kokesh is getting a microphone. We were going to do a fundraiser to get Steve Miller a new microphone, but he's getting one. Thank you, Mav. A lot of fucking shout outs this episode. Jesus. So
it's a collaborative effort.
Yeah. The Lolberts is a collaborative effort. But it's all me. Hashtag please donate. No, I'm just kidding. Don't. I'd rather you shop through my Amazon link than give me money. You buy yourself something.
Unpaid interns, though.
Yeah. A lot of unpaid interns. I just got my thing for the first 2 months. It's like $30 from Amazon. And I've gotten no donations. Oh, Patreon, too. Yeah, Patreon, I do stuff.
I got $12.75, baby. Woohoo.
I'll give you guys
our first payment ever.
I'll give you guys a nickel worth of Zen. Give me yours. Give me.
I can get that through. I can get that from the faucet, man. Yeah. Wait a minute.
That's what I was going to do. I was just going to put your name into the faucet. No, I was kidding. Anyways, I'm not giving you money. I told you this is unpaid work.
I'm fully aware of that.
Yeah, I link your guys' pay stuff. So if you guys want to donate, I'd rather you guys give to them and go through my Amazon link. That's what I really want. Or go through Patreon to me. At least you'll get something out of the Patreon extra. Anyways, so back on track. So Kokesh did a thing where he was going to smoke weed in front of the White House. It would be a big demonstration on 4. I think it was on 420, wasn't it? Probably on 420. It would be stupid not to.
It would make sense.
I think so. I'd have to look at the date, but I'm Sounds right.
So he was doing a big cannabis event where they were going to go in front of the White House, and at 4:20 they were going to smoke a joint. And Kokesh at 4:20, 3, 2, 1, lit up a joint, smoking it. And there was a cop standing right next to him and was like, "Yep, not doing anything about this. This is fine." And everybody was like, "Oh yeah, Adam stood up to the man, and the man back down. Woo!" And Whoa. Then after the protest, they were all kind of standing around, hanging out. And, you know, there was cops kind of walking around, but they were kind of like uninterested at the time. They were just kind of walking around. And then Kokesh meets up with this Afro dude, and they, you know, he lights up a joint, and he's like, and he hands it to Adam, and Adam starts hitting it. And the guy goes, "Yeah, this one's real." And then immediately after he said, this one's real, the cop takes it, they throw the joint on the ground, the cop comes and arrested him, and that's it. And he starts making a big stink, you know, trying to back out, like, "Oh, he's trying to kidnap me," and collapses. And he does what you're supposed to do when you're doing civil disobedience. He finally does what he's supposed to do. What he should have done during this cop arrest, I guess. And it turns out the whole thing was fake. He was not smoking weed. People who were there, and you can actually see the people who are there even say while he's being arrested, "He wasn't even smoking pot."
maybe that's how he learned to turn the camera off in his latest arrest. He's like, "Oh shit."
And I posted a video in the description as well. You can go and watch it. Don't watch like the second half of the video, because the second half of the video is just this constitution liquor, like going on about how Kokesh needs to respect the constitution that he swore to uphold. And he's carrying his own leash, I guess.
Oh yeah, I was just,
he's got a dog on his shirt, so yeah.
Yeah. Does he?
Yeah. It's like a dog with fatigues on.
I was just reading the notes for that, and the guy had to edit it and say he was turning off the comments, so he couldn't read them anymore because apparently he got descended upon by the Kokesh fanboys.
Yep.
And they just constantly attacked him for basically proving exactly what you said.
Yeah.
And they're just mad about it.
The people at the event were saying, "That was not weed. That was not real. This one is real." "That one was not real. He wasn't smoking pot." Like, those were quotes from the fucking thing. Like, come on. How could you deny this? How could you deny the self-evident? A is A. Sorry, go ahead.
Well, he's just counting on the blind stupidity and loyalty of his fan base.
And he knows.
And they
dumb.
Seem to come. Yeah, exactly. They seem to come through. They come through quite often.
Yep. He plays them for a fool, and he's always right. Sorry, guys. Yeah. I know. There's a lot of people who are probably still like kind of waking up out of this thing, and I don't mean to be like personally insulting to you, but we gotta face it. Like, a lot of Kokesh fans, they're not with it, or they're just kind of not paying attention because they just assume that he's on the level, you know, and they're not trying to pick apart this thing or think about it too deeply because they're just like, "Oh, but it's Kokesh and he can't do anything bad, like he's a good guy, right?" I mean, there's it's that kind of tribal thought, and people do that. I'm guilty of doing it too, where people just kind of give the benefit of the doubt because they're in their tribe. And you need you always need to question.
He's a celebritarian. He's got to be one of the good ones.
But there are some people that are genuinely dumb that I've interacted with. Genuinely dumb. But anyways, so we should kind of like end this piece on talking about Macy, because it would be wrong for me to talk about all the bad things that Kokesh has done and not talk about like the extremely toxic kind of things that he does to people that he knows, including his own girlfriend. So I don't know if you guys have ever talked to people who've worked with Cantwell, just, and not even the whole defrauding thing.
Cantwell?
Kokesh. I see them as the same. They're both fraudsters. Kokewell.
So hard to keep them straight.
Yeah, Kokesh. I know a lot of people who have worked with Kokesh who have said, like, "Yeah, this guy like treats us like crap. He's always gaslighting us and all this other stuff," including former girlfriends like Macy Tomlin, who I'm going to also post a link in this as well. And she describes like her entire relationship with him and how he how she like gaslit her into like signing a slave contract to work with him. and just really being like a real big fucking piece of shit to everybody he knows, including, you know, his own fiance, you know. Have you guys heard about any of this stuff as well?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I've watched the videos and, oh, man.
Yeah, I knew this one. And this was just messed up.
Yeah.
This is the heartbreaker. Because
I've met Macy, too. Yeah. I've hung out with her
in
Michigan a couple of years ago. And it was just like, I mean, part of me was like, well, you did sign it. But like everything else I knew about Adam was just like, yeah, he's got to be wrong here somehow. Yeah.
And you know, like I've been in abusive relationships. It's not like that same dynamic, and it wasn't physical abuse. I wasn't getting beat up by a girl, if that's what you're asking now. Like, but I've been in relationships that are like emotionally damaging, and it's really kind of
You were a little too quick to offer that that explanation, Jim. No, I don't know if I buy that.
She didn't hit me, but she was very emotionally abusive. I've experienced that. I know what it was like, and in the middle of it, I kind of snapped out of it myself. I didn't need anybody to tell me, even though they were trying to. But it was kind of like that kind of waking up moment where it's like, oh no, this is the cycle of abuse. I know what this is. Like, I'm going through this. Like, fuck this girl. Mm-hmm. It's happened to me. It's probably one of the reasons why I'm not too keen to hop on the next relationship with another woman. But you know, you've been burned too many times. But anyways,
yeah.
Yeah, it's a very different thing. Like, it's always great when you're outside of it and you're looking at it 2020. Did you say like, oh, you shouldn't have done this and you shouldn't have done that? But it's kind of hard when you're being like manipulated like that in order to kind of really step back and think about things rationally, especially if you're in love with someone. And you can tell by people who love Kokesh that they're not interested in rational explanations about why their Jesus figure is wrong. They're just not interested rationally. And of course they can always look back and say like, yeah, I shouldn't have signed that contract and you know, with Kokesh, and I shouldn't have done this and I shouldn't have done that with them, and I probably would have been okay. But you did, and you weren't thinking about it because you were too wrapped up in emotion, right? Right.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
And that's still no reason to justify treating people like shit, even if it doesn't break the non-aggression principle. Like, you don't treat people like shit. Come on, man.
Right. Even if she signed a contract, yeah. You know what I mean? I mean, I think, like, the hidden or this is kind of underlying tendency to manipulate people, and I wonder how much of that is kind of innate to his personality and how much of it was like picked up or learned from his time in the military as a he was a member of like a civil affairs detachment of the Marines, I believe. He did like a lot of psyops, you know what I mean? So I wonder, it seems like he's kind of mastered the art of finding vulnerable people or people who are maybe naive or whatever, and just kind of finding a way to manipulate them to get what he wants from them. And I think he did this to a fucking T with Macy. And you know, yeah, at the end of the day, she voluntarily did all this shit, but it's so deplorable. You know what I mean?
Yeah. By the way, on a side note, she probably could have thrown blows with me. Like, she was into water polo. Those girls are rough. But we'll never know because it didn't happen.
Oh, thanks, Satan. That never happened, right?
Hail Satan. Shem Ha Parash. Hail Satan.
Full circle.
Yeah, bro. Full circle. Well, we ended up talking about Satanism. Damn it.
I wasn't going to let you get away.
Can't be avoided. Anyway.
So we're wrapping up. So go ahead. Yeah.
Well, I was just going to say, as far as like where he learned it, I don't know. I mean, if he had just been in that position in the Marines, I would assume he'd picked it up there, but like we were talking about earlier, you know, his dad has a tendency to do stuff
right
like this too, so it's probably a combination of the things. But you know, that's one of the things that eventually turned me off to him, was the fact that, you know, on top of everything else, like really paying attention to how he talks to people and what he says. And it's, you know, he likes to tout himself as somebody who uses nonviolent communication, which is something I have a lot of issues with. And I've spoken about this at length many times. I know it's a tool that can be used, but it can be abused to all like
Jeremy,
very easily, and
Jeremy,
so many people don't
feeling,
even start.
I'm feeling very confused.
Good,
and
feel
hurt.
Confused. So
by the way, you're describing the way I talk, and I just wanted you to know that.
Thank you. Thank you for telling me.
It's so condescending.
Exactly. I know.
And manipulative. And
no, I mean, I mean,
but totally nonviolent.
I'm friends with Daryl Becker, who's a big proponent of it and stuff, and I like Daryl, and I can see how it can be used in certain situations, and I've seen how it can be used to diffuse certain situations, but it's just something that it's way too easy for somebody like, say, a sociopathic cult leader type, to pick up on it and make use of it. And I think he even dips into like neuro-linguistic programming and crap like that too, just like with the way he speaks, kind of like Molyneux shit. When you do that type of thing, you're usually just casting a big net and seeing what kind of idiots you can drag in, because those are the people you drag in. And they're those are the ones who will keep supporting you no matter how much evidence is put in front of them.
Yeah. And you know what? Like, cult leaders, virtually every cult leader that I've come across has, you can somehow find ties where they were involved with another cult. Like, for example, Molyneux used to be involved with, what was it? It used to be called Est. Now it's the Forum, or... Was it called?
I have no idea.
Landmark Forum. And then you have, Jesus, I'm so bad right now. L. Ron Hubbard was really involved in OTO, Aleister Crowley and those types, really deep into it. Jack Parsons and stuff. And, but Kokesh, he was in a cult.
Kokesh was in the military.
It was called the United States Marine Corps, and the Marine Corps. I'm serious. They intentionally, and they know that it is, and that's what it's for. Mm-hmm. Like that's the only way you can have a service member is to basically brainwash. They use that brainwash is not an accurate term. Use thought reform techniques in order to get them stripped of their individuality and build another self, like another a person, like another identity. That's basically what brainwashing is you're basically creating them a cult personality and suppressing their original personality. But that's what the United States Marine Corps was about, is basically going through this rigorous process where you're stripped of your individuality and your individual thought and your individual freedom and made to think in line. But that's the only way you can have a military, is to do something like that. So on one hand, it's understandable. The other hand, they go and bomb brown people overseas, which I'm not a big fan of, to say the least.
No.
To say the very fucking least. Yeah.
Well, and like you said, more than anything, I think more than any other branch of service that I'm aware, or at least passingly familiar with, the Marines have cultivated that to almost perfection. You know, it's always like Marine for life. You know what I mean? Like, even when you're out, you're still a Marine. You know what I mean? Even people who are in the Army, like my brothers were in the Army, and they don't talk about it the same way I know people who have been in the Marines do. They are like, once a Marine, always a Marine.
And yep.
It's totally... you're right about that.
He took an oath to defend the Constitution. How dare he? All right, so closing thoughts. Anyone want to wrap this up with a nice, pretty satanic bow with the naked girl under it on an altar?
Oh, man. So many visuals.
Under a Baphomet.
Bleh. lead yourself more than anything.
Yeah.
You know, it sounds cliche, but stop following people and Kokesh is bad.
I have a better way of saying it. And that's wrap your ideas with the ideas and not with the personalities from whom you've heard it from. Like people are really tribalistic, and it's in human nature, and it kind of needs to go. Where you need to just say, like, well, these people in my camp, they agree with me. I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt at all costs, and not try to investigate things or try to whitewash anytime I hear criticism about it, because they're doing it for the cause. And when they actually come down to some sort of terms like, yeah, this is not right, they kind of wash it. Well, it's for the greater cause. It's for a good cause. It's a cause higher than myself. It's a spook, right?
Nice spook.
Yeah. Nice spooks, nerd. I have the best spooks, by the way. I love my spooks. But I recognize
we all do.
Yeah. I recognize that they're spooks. I don't say like if you were to criticize David Friedman, which I would describe myself as a Friedmanite, when in terms of my political views. But if you were to like show me that David Friedman, like, and for as far as I know, he doesn't like gropes women or at conferences or grabs them by the pussy or fucking like beats his children or has raped people or has a bunch of a bunch of dead young boys that he's raped under his crawl space. I'm very willing to go tell me more. I really want to know if this guy's a piece of shit, but I still agree with him politically. And if you want me to disagree with him politically, show me how he's wrong politically. Like I'm very much open to the ideas. I don't wrap my ideas around him. I don't wrap my ideas around LaVey or Stirner. Like you can show me that these guys were terrible people. That'd be fine. But who makes me. Like they don't make me. So if they do something wrong, let me know. I'm more than interested to give it a listen. Really am. But that doesn't change anything about me, right?
Right.
Yeah. Fuck people. It's all about ideas.
Yeah.
Yeah. And don't blindly follow me either. And I know that the people that listen to this podcast don't. And I thank you for that. And a lot of them have challenged me on things. Keep doing that. Like challenge me if I'm absolutely wrong. I want to know. Yeah.
It's like Stephen King said, murder your darlings, Don't grow too
kill your
fond.
Idols.
Kill your idols. Don't grow too fond of any one person.
Yep.
It's actually very easy for me because I've always hated people. So.
Yeah, we're misanthropes. It's easy for us.
comes naturally.
Hashtag misanthropic mongoose, RIP. Rest in peace. Rip in peace. All right, man. Good talking with you guys again.
You too, man.
Yeah, hail Satan.
Ha ha ha.